know, there's just 6,000 layers of information that he's putting together, and I don't know anybody that puts that kind of energy and effort into a piece like he does.
Just see, in a way, his brain at work. How did he think up those various ideas? That's, on its own, a nice exercise to follow.
Dick's artwork actually is quite disturbing for me, but very thought-provoking.
It's a strange combination of realism and surrealism. Strange combination of what the eye sees, what they're used to, and what the mind would see when they apply their mind to the world around them.
That's what attracted me to Dick's work, and that's still what attracts me to Dick's work. It's the curiosity, the playfulness. Dick plays.
For me, personally, it takes a nice gentle world that I'm living in with not lots of heavy traffic, and we have it so quiet out here, and it's so peaceful, and 100 yards from the National Forest to walk in if you want to, and just knowing it's there is maybe enough. My wife is incredibly supportive. She's a puppeteer, so she understands the fine arts, and that's really, really important to have people around that support you, you know.
You know, he's a very down-to-earth, nice guy. His artwork is the part that he is very, very spectacular in. And the rest of him is a really nice person to be around. So it has been no problem. We've enjoyed our married life together from the very beginning. I travel all around the United States. I do between 30,000 and 70,000 miles a year traveling, and do puppet shows any place that will have me. My ideal audience is a family audience. I'd like to have kids and adults at the same time, and hopefully they all come away from it having enjoyed the show. I think it's a dying art, and it's one that's very important to keep alive. Spherefish has been very, very supportive of both of us, especially Dick. They're very, very proud of Dick. It's interesting because he does something that's terribly unusual. And there was a time, both of us, when we were quite a bit younger, my question that people kept asking is, what are you going to do when you grow up? And I would be like 28 years old. And you go, if I'm lucky, I won't. And then I'll be fine. And I think that at first they wanted Dick to be a teacher because they understood that better. But as he continued to not only do his art, but get recognized worldwide for it, they became very proud of him. And we get most of our business at the gallery from the locals sending people out here, saying, "You just one thing while you're in Spherefish, you have to see the Termosphere Gallery."
The first question people usually ask me is, why I paint on globes or on spheres? And the answer to that is that the sphere is the only canvas that will allow you to paint or create total visual worlds. One of the things that is really important to me is, I guess when I look back at what I've done over the years, is that I evidently have been trying to find a way to organize total visual space. And the sphere is the canvas that helps me do that. One of the easiest ways to explain the concept of the thermosphere is to imagine yourself, if you can, being inside of a transparent ball, inside of a transparent sphere. And that particular sphere stays stable and doesn't move, doesn't spin around or anything, it stays stable. Now if you can be up inside of that sphere and can find a really interesting world, like Notre Dame Cathedral for instance, and you find an interesting spot inside the cathedral, And you're in there with this transparent ball in your head, and you copy everything you see around you. You copy what's in front of you on the inside surface of the sphere. What's above you, you paint on the top of the sphere, the ceiling. The floor is painted on the bottom of the sphere, and the northeast, southwest sides of the sphere are totally painted. When you're finished with that, then you take the sphere off your head and you look at it from the outside. And so now all of a sudden what you were inside of looking at, you're now outside of, and there's this mental twist that takes place in your mind. If you're inside this and it's a transparent sphere and you're looking to the north, and let's just say this is the north direction here, this is all the stuff you would see to the north. If you turned exactly around, this is what you'd see to the south direction. Would be 180 degrees around the sphere. So this would be, say, the east direction here, which would be where the vanishing point is in perspective. The opposite side would be your west point. So this would be your west point. Now, with the cubical sort of structure that this is all based on, there's also a projection of all of these lines that come to the bottom point, all of these columns, and they also project towards a point up on the very top. So that gives you your six different directions of space, and I also call it the six-point perspective. Science doesn't usually talk about visual space. That's a weird thing to talk about because it's something that's way out there and it's here close and it's all this stuff. But this organizes it. It puts it all together, and I can do any scene, anywhere, whether I'm out in a landscape, inside of a building, inside the cell of a person, you know, and seeing what's inside the cell of a person. I can be anywhere and create a thermosphere, create this kind of a concept, and it works right. It actually reads properly. When I hit on this idea of six-point perspective and having the ability to capture total visual worlds, that was, and always has been, very exciting to me. Because anytime I go into, like, St. Peter's Cathedral or Notre Dame or the old style saloon in Deadwood or whatever, and I see these incredible total visual environments, I just want to get a sphere in there and capture it, you know. Or I also have another process that kind of grew from this desire to paint or capture total visual environments. And at one point, I started studying how you could do the same thing with photography. And I ended up with a patent on a process called the total photograph.
The total environment, to me, has a lot to do with how computers are coming to understand and imitate reality in their in virtual reality and the seeming together of different aspects so that you can feel like you're going around a whole object or being in a whole environment. It's exactly what Dick has been doing before, you know. He was one of the first people I know to have a computer. He got a little Commodore and we all played games on it. But long before that, he was inventing camera mounts and drawing and trying to explain to us that, you know, these traditional perspective systems aren't really the way the world is.
The sphere has led me both to the very much the subconscious surrealistic world, and it's also attracted me to the opposite end, I would say, of the spectrum of the arts, to the very mathematical, the very geometry side of which ties me into the Escher side of the arts. And both of them have been very interesting to me. In fact, one sphere I did was called organized intuition, which is sort of organized as mathematics. Intuition is a psychology, and I've had interesting connections with, I, like in many cases, have done almost more lectures to mathematicians than I have to the art world. But there's also the psychologists that have, the Carl Jung Society have been very interested in my work and have been in their magazine a couple different times. So I'm very pleased with how what I think of as trying to hang into the universals and trying to talk about what the sphere wants to say instead of dictating my own personality onto the paintings or onto the sphere, trying to read the sphere as what does it want to talk about really helps to jump into the math and into the psychology both.
There's a story about de Kooning who was talking about Norman Rockwell. You couldn't have two more dissimilar painters, but when de Kooning would get up really close to Norman Rockwell's paintings, he would say, he's an abstract expressionist, you know? And Dick has that kind of aspect. If you get up really close to some, you'll see the marvelous way that Dick paints, but he's not painting against a rectangle, and he's painting a continuum that involves geometry and involves, you know, his perspective systems that he understands, but he's also doing these delightful things with surrealism and strange little people sitting in strange little weird environments and so forth. So, see, I mean, Dick is a complete kind of, in the context of art history, kind of one of those guys that tries to pull as many disparate areas of art together to show you, you know, here's what I think it all is.
I'm very interested in surrealism. I'm very interested in what's inside my head, what comes out that I just kind of go, whoa, where'd that come from? You know, that kind of stuff. I'm also very excited about realistic worlds that I call them the famous interiors, partially because I love to travel, but partially because it's very interesting to see how this six-point perspective actually can capture these wonderful architectural environments. And I think one of the parts of that that's intriguing to me is that architects have never really gotten a lot of credit for the amazing kinds of arts pieces they've done over the years. So this kind of draws attention and solidifies it into a sphere, which is fun, to capture it all on the surface of a sphere that you can actually hold St. Peter's in your hand. That's pretty exciting to me.
When you try to define what art is, Susan Langer and some other art philosophers will tell you it's not the piece that's hanging on the wall. You know, a lot of people think that it's about the object, and their thought is art is not a thing, but it's a transaction. It's an exchange between the vision of the artist and the perceptions of the viewer through that form. The form is the vehicle for the transaction, and when that happens, then art happens. And when you have the experience of watching one of these things and watching your mind knit it all together until all of a sudden it's turned inside out and your perception is, okay, I'm in the middle of an environment and I'm looking all around me like this. It's a magical thing. And it's a scientifically accurate thing because that's exactly what the computer has to do to be able to show us the things that we're seeing on the internet now.
This is always fun when people see this because they explain it in, you know, so many different ways. And I'm always just kind of waiting to see how they explain this illusion that they're seeing. But my thought on it is that the reason it's reading concave for you, or the illusion pops out as being concave, is that when I do the painting, I think of myself inside, and so it's sort of carrying on that idea that you really are seeing this from an inside view, and so your mind wants to pop it back into the more realistic way that we normally see, and that's, I think, how most all illusions work anyway. Is you're trying to have something happen that is not normal and you want it to be the normal way you see it. So it pops back into that illusion.
One of the interesting long-standing debates in philosophy has been an old debate that the Greeks attribute to the discussion between Heraclitus and Parmenides. Heraclitus claimed that you can't step in the same river twice, and that the essence of everything is change in constant flow and so forth. And Parmenides said no, and Plato said no, behind that there's an absolute rock solid structure. that there's a ground of being that's absolute, that's underneath all of those things. Basically, that argument is everything in flux and changing all the time, or is there an absolute structure behind all of that stuff? So is there a oneness? I mean, is there a God? Is there an absolute? Or is there just this chaos that's going on and this constant flow and this sense of becoming that we're all involved in? And Dick head-on addresses that.
I try and work very hard at being universal about what I think about. I think my starting many of my canvases, I start with a pure geometry and I work my way toward realism. Whereas most artists work with realism and then they work toward design, which is really geometry. And so I kind of reverse my thinking, because I think that there's so much to be gained by starting with the pure geometries of the world. It's a universal system that is.
I think symbolically with his surrealism and his knitting of the figure ground and so forth, he's showing us some things on some deeper levels of the interconnected, the kind of the mystical quantum interconnectedness of things and how one thing can become another thing. There's a great poem by Jonathan Swift about fleas. And it says, fleas have smaller fleas on them, and these have smaller still that bite them. And so it goes ad infinitum. I think Dick's work is about that. That's the Horton Hears the Who story, you know. Here's a world, and inside that's another world. A lot of people who can access Dick's work, it doesn't have to be necessarily high-level geometry and structure and so forth. There's a lot of joy and fun and celebration in contemporary funky feelings in Dick's stuff that's available to you too.
Lights, action. I also have been told by many people that I remind them of M.C. Escher, which always pleases me because M.C. Escher is one of my favorite artists. This is a 16-inch sphere called Inspirations for Escher. And it shows Escher about three different times in the piece. But the important part of it is it's a little town that Escher is his favorite little town called Ravillo, and it's south of Naples. And the ideas that inspired him for later pieces are showing all around, like the stairway right there where people are coming down. That's like the inspiration for the piece where the people are coming down the stairs and they end up right back where they start from. And if you know your Escher lithographs, you'll spot a lot of, like right now he's holding the mirrored ball in his hands and studying the mirrored ball, and that's his wife up above him. And the date 72 is when he died. That's the number for that apartment. And the little dog is one of his tessellating patterns, and the kids playing soccer in the background, that's one of his tessellating patterns, the dark person and the light person that go around. The devil and the angel are showing up behind him, sitting there in his polyhedrons. And then the guy holding the cube is the ambiguous cube that turns into his waterfalls and some of his illusions also. So there, you know, throughout this, there's like 16 different little pieces, little ideas, inspirations for his work. Escher was fascinated with the mirrored ball because it captured the complete environment around you
on just the one front surface that you look at. And it's a massive amount of distortion around the outer edge of the mirrored ball, but it does capture everything except what's right behind the ball is the only part that's missing. And so I think it's quite similar to what I do with the Termosphere.
I took the concept that he had there and did a sphere of his reflective ball with the motivation that I was going to show what the backside of that sphere would look like too. And which I did, and later I did a video of it, and I had to make up about a third of the sphere is all, because he showed mostly everything was there. My kind of 6-point perspective stretches it out all the way around the sphere more, so it's a little more less distorted than what he showed in his lithograph, which is a flat picture that he did. So I did this sphere of this and completed the back, made up a little bit of stuff in the back, and did a video of it and sent it off to, I got George Escher's address, his oldest son, and sent a video off to him just to see if I could get a response. And he wrote me this wonderful letter.
It showed, among other things, a picture that he had made of a sphere that my father drew that he's holding on his hand. And as he rotated that sphere in the video, it turned out that he had omitted to put a door in it. My father made the picture without a door. And Dick made the rest of the picture. You have to see the thing itself. This thing here. And as you can see, the door is behind the viewer. You can see the wall around. It's a reflecting sphere of his studio in Rome. And Dick, when he completed the sphere, didn't put a door in, so my father could not get in his atelier, really. And so I wrote to him that remarkable, he had a trap door in the floor that he had to climb up every time. Well, I have a strange idea, I suppose, of what the art world is, and it adds its own unique view. It's something that nearly nobody else ever does. Painting on a sphere and requiring the viewer to use his brain to create an illusion, which Dick is trying to present to us. Just see, in a way, his brain at work. How did he think up those various ideas? That's on its own a nice exercise to follow. What students can do with it is exercise their brains. It's, in a way, a game of thinking and letting go of daily inhibitions and assumptions. Otherwise, if they can understand what's going on and copy it and so on, well, you can say that teaches them geometry, whatever, but I think most of all it loosens up the brain. If they manage to get enough looseness, and kids are better at that than older people, they can see those things much more easily. So it just enlarges their view of the world.
It's good to be in the presence. I mean, without making him sound like some sort of spiritual guru, it really is good to be in the presence of Dick Termes and his spheres because, like I said, although it's disturbing, it's also very calming eventually, very settling. And he is so laid back and gentle and kind to bring you along, because it is kind of, it's difficult and a real challenge to understand it. But I've seen him work with people of many, you know, different cultures and different ages and different talents and abilities, and he treats all of us with such respect, and that's, I think, partly because he learns from us. He's one of those kind of artists. He learns from us. We did a fantastic piece at Little Wound, which was named Heart of the Future. And that piece, too, involved a lot of research. That piece became even more of a cultural piece rooted in tradition, in that a lot of the research was to identify the headsmen or the leaders of Medicine Root District down in the Kyle area. And we came to a consensus with several groups collaborating to determine who they would identify as the most significant leaders of the past century coming out of Medicine Root District. That project, it's a polyhedron, which actually, to look at it, you're looking inside of a teepee. But the actual shape of it would be the outside of the teepee, but painted on the outside panels, what you're seeing is the inside of the teepee. You have to be willing, I guess, always to suspend what you know and what you're familiar with in order to let this be. Because on the one hand, it couldn't be. You're not actually looking inside of a teepee. It's shaped wrong. But that's where you are.
When we do work with him, and he does work with our kids, as Wendy mentioned earlier, you know, they do a lot of research. You know, we talk, he involves students in actually doing research. You know, they're actually going out and seeing, who the elders are, what's history behind the artwork that he has worked with our kids. And then when they do express themselves, he always tries to include that in the artwork. I've had the opportunity at two different schools, as Wendy mentioned earlier, at Tokini and now at Little Wound, to work with Dick in those areas there, you know, which is really extraordinary, I think.
In both schools, it was the kids and the teachers that selected the name with community people, named it. Then there was a naming ceremony, and in both schools, we brought in an elder who used sage to smudge the polyhedron. And then we lifted it and danced around it in a circle with a round dance in both schools. So that was pretty special. You know, the whole thing really came together nicely.
Sitting in front of the playground, which was created by the community, he has created a octotetrahedron. You'll have to ask Dick exactly what that means, but it is essentially, it's a way of connecting this particularity of that playground to the rest of the world. He has a series of triangular shapes, which is on the walkway going into the playground. And so if one examines it and thinks about it, one can see that that playground here in Spearfish, South Dakota, is linked to the rest of the world in a whole sort of geometric patterns. One thing I found about modern education, which drives me absolutely nuts, is that we tend to compartmentalize. You must take econ, you must take psychology, you must take history, you must take biology, and stuff like that. And the result is the kid comes out with what I would call a divisive, compartmentalized, less than synoptic vision of learning. In real life, we learn in an integrative, interdisciplinary fashion. I would like to see, and perhaps this is the result of my first few years in college, students take a 14-hour course, and in that 14-hour course, in that 14-hour course, you have history, psychology, writing, philosophy. And I started a number of courses like that at Black Hills, in which, in fact, the kids do learn in an integrative manner.
Dick's work is, I think, a prime example of interdisciplinary across the curriculum sort of. He involves the maths, the sciences, the arts. His subject matter very often is history. And it's so ingrained in him that he doesn't realize he's doing it. he doesn't realize that he's crossing curriculums and doing interdisciplinary things, because it all is so integral a part of his work that it has to belong there. So I think it's a terrific leader as far as what can be done with the interdisciplinary approach.
Dick came up with, of course, a circular image of the state of the university. A snake eating a snake eating a snake, in which ultimately the snake died because its extremities were being cut off, and ultimately it ate its own head. The result is the president at that time was quite upset with Dick, but I think it clearly articulated a vision, and I think perhaps it's what we may see happen in public schools. Oh, where do we cut? Let's cut band out. Ah, what do we cut? Let's cut art history out. And the result is we eat ourselves.
Years ago I did this art piece, and I really didn't know what I was doing when I did it, but it just was kind of a fun thing. What I did was I had a hemisphere. I had this leftover half of a ball, and I mounted it with a post underneath it, and I put a motor in that post, so it was hidden, and the rod from the motor came up, and I tied a little styrofoam ball on the end of that rod, and it was up in the bowl. I threw a whole bunch of styrofoam balls inside this hemisphere, so it was like popcorn kind of. All the balls are the same size inside here, including the one that was tied to the motor. Plugged the motor in, the motor turned the one ball, and it started turning everything else. Everything was turning off of each other. So the whole thing was moving and turning, and it was just really kind of fun to look at, because if you were interested in gears, you could start to see, okay, this is turning this, and it makes this turn this way, and it's turning this and this way, and everything was turning. So I left it for about 10 minutes in the gallery, came back and looked, and it was stopped. The one little ball on the bottom was spinning. All the rest of these were stopped. I moved it a little bit, everything started turning. It looked like, oh, fine, it's gonna turn. And so everything was turning, walked away, came back, it was stopped again. So I thought, huh, interesting, there's a geometry problem here. When all the balls are the same size, it stops. So what I did was I found a little tiny ball, a little smaller, threw it in there, and it turned, and it turned, and it turned, never stopped. And I thought, now, this is interesting. What is this like in society? If you have all the balls the same size and you don't have any little oddball that's stirring up society like an artist does, society gets stagnant and it stops. And I think that's what happens. That's what can happen in America or in the world. If you don't have respect for the people that are creating the new ideas, creating the new stuff, that are out on a limb, sometimes frustrating you too, because they're trying to change society. They aren't just trying to change designs in society. Sometimes they're trying to change how we think about society. And artists do all that stuff. There isn't like just artists aren't just painters, or not just painters and theater and music people. They're all the people, I think, that are that are stimulating the new things. They could be bankers, they creative bankers. They get pushed out because they're trying to change the system. We don't want them in here, and we throw them out. Well, if you throw out too many of those people, the system stops. And that's what I think that little piece talks about.
When I've taught, and I did teach for 12 years at an academic level, I always told my students it's all about problem solving. And in Dick, I saw a very, very obvious example of that. Dick did not get into painting on spheres because he wanted to solve mathematical equations or be involved in mathematical theory or anything like that. He was curious, and he was looking to solve a problem that perplexed him. And that, to me, is the first thing that really excited me about Dick's work and drew me to his work. And that still is the attraction for me. It's the problem solving.
There's all kinds of geometries I haven't explored yet. And it seems like each geometry system, whether it's the rhombic triacontahedron or all of those. You start with some of that stuff, and it just starts telling you where it wants to go. So I just kind of jump on. I'm just kind of riding along for the ride.
The thing that Dick's work brings out, which is, again, the problem-solving issue, is to me what is so important about art as being part of a liberal arts education. It encourages you to think about possibilities, and it encourages you to analyze a problem with the idea that there's more than one solution.